Hey guys, Nuan here with Movie Slinger Reviews. Today we are going to talk about another forgotten film, Last Action Hero. Enter Danny Madigan. He's a teenager from New York that loves spending his free time at his local movie theater. He even cuts school to go watch movies. His mother keeps yelling at him about his movie watching habits, but Danny doesn't care. All he cares about is watching Arnold Schwarzenegger's latest film, Jack Slater 4.
Like I didn't know that. They killed second cousin. Big mistake. Jack Slater 4.
And this latest sequel is the debut of Jack's daughter, Whitney. She's the hot girl from Mortal Kombat, so obviously Danny has a schoolboy crush on her. Now, hang on a minute. Crush on the hot girl, remembers all of Arnold's one-liners, and mother complains about movie-watching habits? This kid is totally me.
That's me.
Danny's friend Nick, the old guy that runs the movie theater, invites Danny over to watch Jack Slater 4 before the premiere. And since Danny doesn't have a real ticket, and since Nick is a little eccentric, he brings out this old ticket that he claims was given to him by Houdini when he was Danny's age, and it's supposed to have magic powers. They don't really think much about it, but they use the ticket probably just to mark the occasion. There's a bit of not so subtle foreshadowing here with the Pandora reference. So Danny goes into the theater, the film projector starts rolling, you hear the Megadeth soundtrack, and the movie begins. And after a while, Danny realizes that the film is starting to feel a little too interactive when some dynamite leaps out of the screen and into the theater. After the dynamite goes off, Danny wakes up in Jack Slater's car. Houdini was right, it is a magic ticket and it can open a doorway to your wildest dreams. In Danny's case, an action movie starring Arnold. One thing I really like about Danny's character is that after a fair bit of freaking out, which is totally understandable, he realizes exactly what is happening and embraces it.
This is a movie set. This is a movie set. That's how the scenery changed, right?
Think about it, he's living what we movie fans always fantasize about, to actually be in a movie, hang out with your favorite characters and go on an adventure. It's like being inside the Matrix, but instead of pale and dull Keanu Reeves, Danny gets to hang out with Arnold.
No. Why?
Now don't get me wrong, I think Keanu is breathtaking, but Arnold has always been my favorite action hero. I grew up watching his films and I even like his bad ones. So you can imagine how Last Action Hero speaks to me on a very personal level. Jack Slater could very well be my favorite Arnold character if it wasn't for the T-800. It's too close to call. This is without a doubt a very exaggerated version of the kinds of action heroes that Arnold usually plays. Everything you love about him is there and dialed up to 11. The bad puns.
You want to be a farmer? Here's a couple of acres.
The cigar in his mouth, and obviously a high body count for the bad guys.
Don't give up your day job.
He's super confident and very charming, almost at that Superman level of charming. Even his clothes are red and blue. So with Danny now inside the movie, the story starts to veer away from whatever the original script was. Things are changing because Danny is there. Obviously the bad guys kill Slater's favorite second cousin.
I'm out of here.
Big mistake, I know. But since Danny saw the bad guys coming up with their evil scheme while he was still eating popcorn, Jack and his captain get a little suspicious. How does this kid know so much? After a brief interrogation, the captain makes Danny the new partner for Jack Slater. That's right, Danny is now Jack's partner. Now, if you thought that was dumb, well, it is dumb, but it's also a 90s action movie. It's supposed to be dumb, and that's one of the most hilarious and consistent running jokes in Last Action Hero. Everything inside the movie works with movie logic. It knows exactly what it is and it doesn't hold back. The dumber the cliche, the more the filmmakers seem to have embraced it. Here's a list of cool stuff that just works with movie logic. All the cars explode when Jack shoots at them. The music changes when Jack changes the cassette tape. All the bad guys love to talk too much and reveal their plans.
Man, are you an idiot? You made the classic movie mistake. Don't explain so much. You had to get in those last few words. I mean, if you had just fired, you would have won. But no, you're the typical villain. Dumb.
Jack Slater's wardrobe is full of identical red t-shirts and jeans. All the women are stunningly gorgeous. Jack Slater can't actually die inside the movie.
He's okay, minor wound. Both cops dead.
The bad guy is using dynamite sticks out of an Acme dynamite box. The angry police captain that shouts at the hero all the time. This ice cream truck exploding, and this guy dying from an ice cream cone, and then the resulting pun.
I asked that guy, cone of phrase.
In fact, some of the best parts of this buddy movie relationship is Danny trying to convince Jack that it's not real and Jack coming up with an excuse that is built on movie logic. It makes total sense to Jack, but that just makes Danny roll his eyes. He tries to point out that all the women are attractive.
I mean, where are the ordinary, everyday women? They don't exist because this is a movie!
No, this is California.
He takes Jack into a video store to show Arnold's movies, only to find...
No! It isn't possible!
What's not possible? He's fantastic. This is his best performance ever.
But that was you! You were in that movie!
You were in a movie?
Yes.
The interesting part is that Jack has noticed that some things have gotten harder in recent years. He's divorced, he's haunted by memories of a loved one that died, he talks about how all he wanted to do was to be an ordinary cop, but he kept getting involved in all these crazy, over-the-top adventures. He doesn't understand, but us movie fans know what happens in the sequels, right? The sequels get bigger and more difficult for the characters. It's rather interesting that here, what we, the audience, takes for granted, the fun that we get through this escalation of action and epic set pieces is going to be psychologically devastating to a real person. It's not actually fun if it happened for real. And it's here that Last Action Hero offers some much needed dramatic weight and shows that it's not just a parody, it's not just for laughs. Jack Slater is more than a two-dimensional character, and maybe because Danny, a real person, is there by his side, he's starting to think like a real person too. And he starts to think beyond the role his screenwriters wrote for him. Jack slowly begins to believe Danny's story and they eventually leave the movie world. That's right, the entire third act takes place in the real world. And this is where Jack and Danny's relationship is really put to the test. Because in our world, cars don't explode and Jack is human, which means if he got shot, he could actually die. So Danny is worried that Jack's overconfidence would get him killed, and Jack is upset because he thinks Danny doesn't believe in him anymore. So there's some great drama on top of their relationship, which is starting to develop into a father-son type of thing. It's not as developed as the John Connor and T-800 relationship, but it works. With Jack Slater being in the real world, we get an intriguing third act reversal of the movie logic that has so far carried most of the humor. It's still funny because now we get to see Jack confront all the things he was never meant to interact with.
Here's another explosion for your movie, kid. Not a word. Not one word.
One of my favorite running jokes is the Mozart joke, which pays off here.
What's that?
Mozart.
The guy practice killed?
That's right, Jack.
And of course, real-world logic dictates that the bad guys can win. So let's talk about our antagonist. To fight the best action hero, you need the best villain. When people talk about the best villains, what are the usual suspects? Star Wars fans would say Darth Vader. Of course, some fans would say Rian Johnson is the real villain. There's of course the Joker, Sauron from Lord of the Rings. Not you, Voldemort. and of course Blofeld from the James Bond movies and many, many more. Allow me to suggest a long overdue inductee into the Bad Guy Hall of Fame, Mr. Benedict, played by Charles Dance. This guy is one of my favorite movie villains ever, and he's a proper British villain too. He drinks tea, is always impeccably well dressed, and corrects bad grammar. He's smart, resourceful, and very handy with a gun, obviously. And Charles Dance effortlessly steals every scene he's in. He's clearly enjoying himself in this role. His henchman looks like Oddjob from James Bond, and he has highly trained attack dogs.
Make no mistake, they are exceptionally well trained.
He's dangerous enough in the movie, but in our world, he realizes he's even more effective. He realizes he can actually win. And with Jack Slater being human now, that becomes a frightening possibility. And once Benedict gets hold of the magic ticket, he starts stacking the odds against Jack and Danny, and it leads to some surprising and hilarious confrontations as we reach the climax of the film. I love this movie because it exposes and makes fun of the cliches of the action genre while simultaneously celebrating it. It's winking at the camera and laughing with its audience. It takes the genre's most recognizable face, not you Stallone, and exaggerates him to a comical degree and then allows us to sympathize with him. Jack really begins to hate the filmmakers who created him. So who are these filmmakers? Well, one of the screenwriters is Shane Black. I wasn't aware of Shane Black when I was a kid watching this, but now after watching Kiss Kiss Bang Bang and The Nice Guys, I'm really not that surprised. His blend of humor and passion for the action genre and also making fun of Hollywood works really well here. The director is John McTiernan. That's right, the same guy who did what are arguably the two biggest action films of the 80s with Predator and Die Hard. With Predator, he showed how your traditional 80s macho men are scared shitless when they go against this alien hunter. And with Die Hard, he introduced a new kind of hero, a normal guy in the wrong place at the wrong time. And after revitalizing the genre twice, he's now doing a parody of it. I honestly don't think Last Action Hero would have worked without McTiernan. It takes a good director that's already comfortable in the genre and who's willing to break its logic to make a movie this fun, have this much heart, and actually be a good action movie in its own right. 21 Jump Street and Hot Fuzz are hilarious action parodies and I love them, but they're not very good action films. Last Action Hero is a good action film. Look at some of the great stunt work at the funeral. There are plenty of amazing action sequences in this film. Last Action Hero is one of the earliest films I remember watching in the movie theater. I'm not sure exactly what that was. It was either this or Jurassic Park. And if you're wondering, hey, if this movie is so awesome, how come I've never heard about it? Well, I just mentioned why. Remember that little film called Jurassic Park? Last Action Hero opened on the same weekend, so obviously it got stomped on really hard by the dinosaurs. Now, apparently leading up to the release, before Jurassic Park's enormous success was a foregone conclusion, people speculated which movie would be more successful. It seems crazy in retrospect, but when you think about it, it makes sense. Arnold was the biggest movie star at the time, and Last Action Hero could have looked like a legitimate threat to Jurassic Park. And when the hype started building for the dino flick, Arnold had tried to delay Last Action Hero by a few weeks, but the other producers were worried it'll lose money and create negative publicity, so they didn't do it.
That's a big
mistake. That is what you were gonna say, right? Gee, how would I know that?
No one likes a smart ass.
And the rest is history. Jurassic Park became the highest grossing movie at the box office, and now most people don't even know what Last Action Hero is. Of course, it didn't help that reviews for the film were mixed, and most of Arnold's action fans didn't like the idea of him parodying himself at the time. This type of self-aware breaking the fourth wall humor seems to work very well nowadays. Look at Deadpool, for example. Unfortunately, Last Action Hero seems to be about 25 years ahead of its time. Can you imagine if this was made today?
You know, there's lots worse things in movies. There's politicians and wars and forest fires and famine, plague, sickness, pain, warts, politicians.
You already mentioned it.
I know I did. They're twice as bad as anything else.
But whatever, even if it wasn't successful, it's still Arnold at the top of his game, and I love it. I hope I've convinced you to check this out. It's consistently entertaining and really brings out the childhood joy, that sense of magic that only watching a good action film can bring. If I haven't convinced you, here's cool stuff that you're missing out on. Spoilers, don't say I didn't warn you. When Danny is at school and his teacher refers to Shakespeare's Hamlet as one of the first action heroes, and then Danny zones out and dreams of Arnold as Hamlet.
To be or not to be? Not to be.
This line delivery by Mr. Benedict, which oozes with evilness.
If God was a villain, he'd be me.
Jack Slater keeps getting Arnold's name wrong.
You think you're funny, don't you?
I know I am. I'm the famous comedian, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Schwarzenegger.
Disentite.
Danny asking Jack to say the F word, but Jack can't because the movie is PG-13.
Say this.
Hey, grow up.
Benedict teasing other movie villains he can bring into our world.
We'll have a nightmare with Freddy Krueger. Have a surprise party for Adolf Hitler. Hannibal Lecter can do the catering.
The ticket brings death out of a movie. And death is played by Sir Ian McKellen. Gandalf is in the house and it's one of the best cameos ever. The musical score by Michael Kamen alongside bands such as AC/DC, Def Leppard and Megadeth. This movie deserves some love and I'm gonna shout from the rooftops till more people notice The Last Action Hero. Thank you guys for watching this video. So, have you guys watched Last Action Hero? Please leave your thoughts in the comments and don't forget to like and subscribe. Movie Slinger out.